Maintaining your faith, or maintaining your focus, rather, on God.
Amen.
Maintaining your focus on God. I have discovered that maintaining your focus on God is not automatic, but it is a learned behavior. For the Bible says in Isaiah 26:3, he who keeps his mind on God, God will give him or keep him in perfect peace. Now the word focus means to concentrate one's efforts or attention on something in particular. You see, concentrating your attention and efforts on God is a learned behavior. And if you do this, determine a time of life that's going to come. They will cause you not to lose your focus on the promise that God has made you. When you concentrate your efforts and your focus on God, several times are going to come. So when you focus your attention on God, when you maintain your focus on God, it causes you to be steady. Because troubles sometimes are going to come. Everybody that's sitting in this room, at some time or another, you have been under the weight of pressure. But don't look at it as being strange, because it's going to happen. For the Bible said that any man that lives godly in Christ Jesus, he's going to suffer persecution, or he's going to have trying times. And a lot of these trying times, or these adverse circumstances, they come through people. And Satan works through people.
Yes, sir.
Did you not know that you can have a friend that's jealous of you? Did you not know that you can have an acquaintance that's jealous of you, and they don't want the very best for you? So therefore, they'll begin to say things to you, not realizing that they are allowing their tongue to be used by the devil. I wish I had somebody that was going to pray. Now I want you to listen to me very carefully. Now it is impossible to maintain your focus on God and the pressures of life at the same time. Let me say that again. I want you to listen to me now. It's impossible to maintain your focus on God and your pressures at the same time. Because if you are preoccupied with the pressure of life, it's going to blind you to God's way of escape. Did you not know that God had a way of escape? For God told Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. And the reason why you don't understand it is because you are looking not at me, but you are looking at the pressures that has come against you. Because the Apostle Paul, he had prayed three times to the Lord, Lord, please remove these problems from me. The Bible called it a thorn in the flesh. But it wasn't nothing of trouble that was caused by Satan. So Paul had gone to God on three occasions, asking the Lord to remove the pressure, to remove this thorn in the flesh that is coming from Satan. But the Lord replied to Paul and said, my grace is sufficient. And the reason why you haven't seen this thus far, because you're too preoccupied with the pressures at hand. So therefore, it's impossible to maintain focus on God and the pressure of life at the same time. Do I have a witness? And if you continue to do that, you're going to miss God's way of escape. In other words, because of your misplaced focus, and misplaced focus in a biblical sense means that you are more concerned with your circumstances in life rather than maintaining your focus on God and the things of God. Did you not know, saints, that God has provided a way for you to escape? His grace is sufficient. But now, let me ask you the question. Where are you looking when money get tight? When your children won't behave? When it seems like everything has arrayed itself against you? Now, my question to you, where are you focusing your concentration? Where are you focusing your attention? You are looking at that, what you can see and what you can feel. But it's impossible now to focus your attention on God and the presence of life at the same time. Something is going to have to give. So I said earlier that maintaining your focus on God is a learned behavior because it doesn't happen automatically. It is something that you have to put into practice. In other words, when your back is against the wall, you must begin to look to the heel from which your help comes. And your help comes from God. See, but you have to get it in your stubborn mind. I don't have to understand which way God is coming from.
Right.
But I know that, and I have faith to understand, that God is going to come and deliver me out of my trials and my tribulations. Because I already understand that he said that he will never leave me, nor forsake me. So God is not a man that he shall lie. So if he said, and I remind him that he said that he will never leave me nor forsake me, therefore I must maintain my focus on that. You have to understand, Nicole, that his words are forever settled in heaven. Heaven and earth will pass away before one tittle of God's word fails. So I have to learn in the midst of trouble where my help is coming from. So out of these years that I've lived, I've discovered that he always has a way to escape. But I have to find it. But now, if I'm preoccupied with the trouble at hand, I'm going to miss the way to escape. Do I have a witness? And see, trials, tribulations, and trouble are real. It takes a real man and a woman to be able to say no to that and say yes to God.
Right.
See, because I told you that it's a learned behavior to maintain your focus on God. In other words, you can't get to this point tiptoeing and skipping the church. You have to be in here to learn from someone that has already been through it. And I raise my hand and say that I've been through it because some of the things, most of the things rather, that I teach and preach to you, I have literally gone through it. Now, I did not say that it's easy to maintain one focus on God. I didn't say it was easy. So please don't try to put that on me. But what I am saying, it is possible. But the problem with human men and women, we preoccupy ourselves with the things that we can see. But the Bible says, while we look not at the things which are seen, but the things which are unseen, for the things that are seen are temporal, are temporary, but the things that are not seen are eternal. So I got my focus on the eternal word of God, which never changes. I don't have to understand how this is going to happen. I don't have to understand then it's going to happen. All I have to know is that God has my back.
Amen.
And if God got my back, He has your back. I'm talking about maintaining your focus on God. Now, at one time or another, all of us, we have been under the weight of pressure. And nobody likes that. Nobody likes being under the weight. And you know, have you ever had somebody sitting on you that was heavy? And you know, they give a weight down. That didn't feel good, did it? So pressure in life sometimes is like somebody sitting on you. And you want them to get up off of you because they are hurting you. So the pressures of life, they are designed to hurt you. But you have to learn how to maintain your focus on God. Now, at one time or another, all of us have had that weight of pressure on us. And most of that pressure was untimely and it was temporary. But when you were going through it, it seemed like it was going to last forever. And if you don't maintain your focus on God, listen to me. You're going to start to save and do things that are wrong. You're going to start and do things that are wrong. In other words, you start trying to solve things that God said that He was going to take care of Himself. Have you ever, or do you believe, rather, that you can actually get in the way of God?
Yes.
You can get in the way of God with your mouth.
Yes.
You can get in God's way with your actions.
Yes.
And so you find yourself in a position when you're trying to solve something that God said that He was going to take care of.
Right.
But because you're preoccupied, you got it on your mind. Man, I'm in trouble. How am I going to get out of this? You know, will I lose my car? Will I lose my home? You know, my body is not feeling well and what have you. You're preoccupied. It's on your mind. And I just told you that it's impossible to maintain focus on God and the problem at the same time. Now, let me suggest to you that you need to make up your mind what you're going to do.
All right.
You don't just show up to church and just hear the man of God teach and preach and go home and say, oh, well. Yeah, he really wasn't talking to me. He was talking to Paulette and him. He wasn't talking to me. I'm perfect, man. He wasn't talking to me. He was talking to Mel and him. He wasn't talking to me. Oh, yeah, I was talking to you. Talking to you. Sitting up in the church, thinking about what's going to happen Monday, instead of listening to what God wants to say to you in here today. That stuff tomorrow will take care of itself. See, but you up in here, and you would say, you're thinking about the roast that you're going to cook this evening, but no, let's get a little deeper than that. You're thinking about, man, the trouble that you think is awaiting you or going to befall you next week. Get your mind off of that. Don't be so concerned about that where it paralyzes you and you can't go forth. See, sometimes people are so fearful until they are paralyzed, they can't make the next move.
Right.
See, that is somebody that is a Christian, but have not learned to walk as a Christian. See, one thing about Christianity I found in my walk with God, it is a lifestyle. It is not something that I get dressed up and just to come to church on Sunday and say, hello, how you doing? Oh, blessed you in the name of the Lord, and give somebody a little soft kiss, a little, you know, weak hug and what have you. Christianity goes much deeper than that, baby. Because Jesus Christ gave His life that we might be saved. So therefore, I'm talking about maintaining your focus on God. And the reason why it's so imperative, the reason why it's vital, because Paulette, God had a way provided for me to escape. Mm-hmm. Even though he sees what I'm going through, but a lot of times it's necessary to go through the difficult times. It's necessary sometimes, because the Bible has already talked about it. It's necessary to go through it, because what it does, it really trains you. But when God has saw and seen, rather, that you have learned a lesson, then God will provide the way to escape. Now, when the Lord spoke to the Apostle Paul, after he had prayed to him on three occasions about the thorn that was in his flesh, and like I said, the trouble was coming from Satan. The trouble was coming to harass him when he was preaching and teaching and whatever. Satan would show up and a demon would begin to get the people and harass Paul and got all into the services and whatever, you know, the teaching sessions and whatever. And Paul got tired of it. And he went to God and said, you know, Lord, would you remove this? Would you get rid of this? And the Lord told him, said, my Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace is sufficient. So when Paul looked at that and understood what the Lord was saying, he said, oh, it was like a light that came on. In other words, Paul was saying that I've been looking in the wrong area. I've been looking at everything. I've been preoccupied with this trouble instead of focusing my attention on the one who has the grace. And he said that my grace is sufficient. But now, you'll never see it if you're so concerned with what you're going through. I understand that they might be plotting against you. Don't you realize that God understands that they're plotting against you? God understands that when somebody don't like you. God understands when somebody is jealous of you. God understands when someone is plotting to try and take your life. God understands and sees all of that. But when you get down on your knees and say, Lord, dispatch your angels to watch over me.
Amen.
Direct my steps, lead me, yes. Guide me, yes. Strengthen me every step of the way.
Yes. Yes.
And Lord, I pray that I will find favor in your sight. And Heavenly Father, if anyone is plotting against me, Heavenly Father, I stand there in your word which says, no weapon formed against me shall prosper.
Yes, indeed.
No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And Lord, I'm reminding you that you said this, and I'm standing on your word, so I'm going to maintain my focus on you, and I'm not going to maintain my focus on them over there. When I know that they are coming against me, I'm going to simply look to you. Did you not know that God got more power than the judge?
Yes.
Did you not know that God got more power than the doctor, and he's more educated than the doctor?
Yes.
Did you not know that the Lord have, he's more articulate than the best lawyer that you can find?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Did you not know that the Lord is more, he's more knowledgeable than the best mechanic that you can find?
Yes.
See, God can fix your car without picking up a screwdriver, without picking up a wrench. I mean that God can do it all. So why are you so preoccupied with what you are going through instead of maintaining your focus on God? When sooner or later, somebody listen to me, sooner or later, God will straighten it out.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
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 Sooner or later, you're going to get up one morning and you're going to find that that stuff that's been plaguing you, it's gone. It's nothing but a bad memory.
Mm-hmm.
But the reason why I stand there so long is you keep holding on to it and won't let God have it.
Pastor, preach.
See, some of the stuff that is holding on to us is holding on to us because we're holding it. And we won't let God have it. Because we are preoccupied with it. And when you're preoccupied with something, guess what? It's going round and round and round in your head. And you can't think about nothing but that.
Amen.
Oh, yeah. How do y'all beat me up?
All right.
I've done it.
All right.
That's why I can talk to you about it.
Amen.
Y'all better listen to me. See, I'm not so prone to talk about trouble. You can ask my wife about it. I don't be talking about no whole bunch of trouble, but y'all, I don't. You know why? Because death and life is in the power of the tongue. If I'm going to say anything, I'm going to say something about the positive regarding the circumstances and situation. Oh, yes, I see it. I think it's going to be all right. But in my mind, I want to say something else. But I learned the game. If I can say that in layman's term, I want to say something else other than what I'm saying. But I know that it's not good to say sometimes what you are hearing going on in your head.
Yeah.
So it's best to say what God says.
Yeah.
Because God can only watch over his word to perform. So you have to learn how to maintain your focus on God. When I'm talking positive, something negative won't arrive the soul. I want to say just like it is. I want to say how I'm feeling.
Yeah.
I want to say what I don't have. I want to say that it's never going to get any better. I want to say that those people get on my nerve, but no, I keep it here. And if I'm going to say anything, I'm going to say what God says, because I've learned to maintain my focus on him. Give the Lord a hand. You better get up and around, folks. That's always talking negative. You better get up and around. See, because next thing you know, that stuff you done got on you. Have anybody here been around somebody negative? I mean, they every time they're talking gloom and doom all the time. I don't want to be around like that. See you later. I'm gone. But you're not going to get me off into that trap.
Amen.
You know?
Amen.
Let's turn into 1 Corinthians. The 10th chapter. 1 Corinthians 10. In one verse. The 13th verse. I want you to notice, Kathy, what this verse is saying here. As 1 Corinthians 10th chapter, 13th verse, that has no temptation taken you but such as cometh to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer or permit you to be tempted above that which you are able. But he will with the temptation also make a way to escape that you might be able to bear. Notice, say, God will with the temptation, or will with the trouble that you're going through. He's right there with you in it.
Amen.
But he's not going to permit you to go through anything above that which you are able to go through.
Yeah.
So he will with the temptation that's trying you. In that, he's providing a way for you to escape. Because God, he uses what we go through sometimes to teach us valuable lessons. And I didn't say that it feel good. See, you have been warned in the word of God that these things are going to happen. So when it seems like everything negative has arrayed itself against you, you have to understand that God is right there. And he's permitting you to go through it because he's training you, because what you are going through, it repeats itself. It's going to come back again.
All right.
So when you make it through it this time, you're going to say, I've been through this before. So if God took care of it the last time, he's going to take care of it this time. But you learn this when you learn to maintain. Don't focus on God. You can't focus on the trouble. And God is saying, did you not know that? Did you not know that you can't be worried about putting the focus on what they're doing and seeking God's faith at the same time? calling up Sally, calling up Daddy, calling up Mama, calling up Pookie, calling up Ray Ray. You don't know what they're doing to me or whatever, so you're preoccupied with the problem instead of looking at you. I feel like I'm not calling nobody.
Yeah.
If I'm calling anybody, it's going to be God.
Yeah.
Let your request be made known unto the Father. Isn't that what he said?
Yeah.
He said, be careful, or don't be anxious for anything. But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to Pookie. It didn't say that. Let your request be made known to God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, so God's heart and mind through Christ Jesus. Didn't I just read? Didn't I just quote rather? Isaiah 20, I think it was 26 and 3. It says, he who keeps his mind on God, God will keep him in perfect peace. So I got my mind on God. Possibly, is that possible? Yeah. You're thinking about something, ain't you? Everybody in here got a thought pattern. You're thinking about something now. I hope you're thinking about what I'm talking about. Every day, every minute, every hour, you're thinking about something, some thought going through your mind, your head. And sometimes you sit there smiling.
Yeah.
Thinking about it. You better get that nonsense out your head. Thinking about somebody that can help you, so here goes with you. In the midst of your trouble, he'll go with you.
Yeah.
He's right there by your side. And eventually, if you focus on him on a consistent basis, you'll see the way to escape.
Yes.
Yeah. Wow, you mean to tell me I don't have to be arguing, fussing, and fighting and debating over this?
No. Right.
Because you got the master in the arena.
Yeah.
And he has promised you that he's going to take care.
Yes.
But now, it's a learned behavior.
Yes, it is.
It's nothing that you're going to pick up automatically.
No.
It's something that comes, you know, in time.
Mm-hmm.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Let's look at Psalm 121. Thank you, and I feel like teaching. Psalm 121. Let's look at what it says. And I quoted this verse. I quoted just a little bit of it just a minute ago, but we're going to read the entire chapter. It's a short chapter. That's first Psalms 121. It's the number of Psalm, not chapter, numbers of Psalm. Psalms, the 121, number of Psalms, verses 1 through 8. Now here's what it says. I will lift up my eyes unto the hill. From whence cometh my help? My help comes from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall not slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by the day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth, even from evermore. So the Lord is concerned about you. Will the Lord let you have your way?
Mm-hmm.
Yep,
yeah. I wonder why, Ray, will the Lord let you have the way? I wonder, Kim, will the Lord let you have the way? Because he has given you a free will.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord will permit you to go down with the ship. To go down with the ship. The Lord will permit it. If you don't seek it, the Lord will say, well, you're not going to have already shared with you how to get out of this and how to get around this, mm-hmm. how to avert this. But since you chose to do your thing, I'm going to let you have your way. And you might have some people that want to argue with that. Pastor Reese been around long enough, Junior, to understand that what you say is nothing but foolish garbage. The Lord will let you have your way.
Yep.
If a person want to go to hell, God will let them. He won't stop them, but what the Lord will do. And he has done everything he can to keep you out of that place. But no, I'm going to have my way. And I feel that when I have lived my life, then I give my life to Jesus. But you don't know what tomorrow holds.
Amen.
You don't know what tomorrow holds. Amen. You may not get the opportunity to acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So if you don't do that, how are you going to get there? You won't.
That's right.
So you must learn early as you can, how to get this relationship and establish this relationship and maintain this relationship with God. All that's up to you. God, I mean, when you look at it and study it, what a genius. I'm talking about God.
Yes.
He provided everything we need to get from the earth to heaven. He provided everything. Everything. The only thing that God required out of you is just to receive it.
Yep.
To receive it. And one thing about it, that once you receive it, God is released to do this miracle in you. Because it can only be done by God. Man can't save you with no magic wand. It takes the word of God.
Yeah.
To save you. And once God saves you, you've got that he gives you his spirit, and you are able now, or have the potential rather, to begin to follow God.
Amen.
You have the potential, whereas you didn't have the potential before. But now you have the potential to follow God. And some people, by exercising their own will, they decide that I don't follow God long enough. I'm tired of this. I'm tired of this going to church. I'm tired of this reading the Bible. I'm tired of this prayer. I'm tired of all of that. So I'm going to do my own thing for a little while. But the Bible said that he that endures to the end shall be saved. He that endures to the end. In other words, Junior, when you get in, it wouldn't be prudent to take sabbaticals. It would be prudent to get in it and keep walking with God. Because you're going to have some demons, some devils that have been assigned to you to try to detach you from God if you don't learn how to maintain your focus on it. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing to come to church and hear what God is saying. You mean to tell me God is speaking through that old man? I knew him. You know, when he was out there, you know, like in the backyard cussing and drinking and fussing and all that. And you know, he up in the pulpit trying to preach. You mean to tell me God is speaking through him? Let's break it down. The Bible says, if a man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away, behold, all things have become new. So this old Bob that you're talking about,
old things,
that was in the backyard drinking, fussing and cussing and all that. See, what happened? He got a hold of Jesus, and Jesus got a hold of him. See, God picked him up, shook him, shook all of that nonsense out of him, stuck him behind a pulpit, and guess what? He got something to say now. So you ought to look at that and say, if God did that for Bob, surely God can do it for me. But what God does for you now, you got to maintain and keep that relationship going that you have established with God and the relationship that he has established with you. I look to the hill from which my help comes. All of my help comes from the Lord. And they say, look to them, look to her, look to them. It just said that I look to the hill, it's talking about God. Because my help comes from him is something that you have to learn how to do.
Yes.
Something that you have to learn how to do. You know, some people get saved, they come into the kingdom of God, thinking that they're going to automatically be rich.
No.
Far be it, baby. You can be rich in God. Now, if you establish yourself where you can become rich, God doesn't have anything to do. God is not against that. But Jesus took time to say something about people that are going after money.
Go ahead, Pastor.
Talks about the love of money.
Teach.
Is the root of all evil.
Teach.
And he also said, Pam was talking, you know, just the other day, and Pam was talking about, you know, like Jesus made the statement. He said that it will be easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle,
yes,
than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. So let me share this now. I know money helps with all things. I know it's good to have it, to buy what you want to and all of that, but guess what? Money can misplace your focus on God. Money can misplace your focus. In other words, you start to pay more attention on it rather than God. And the next thing you know, you way out here, and you have left your walls with God. Now, isn't that an illustration? Lydia will probably tell you what's out of the house legally. It's a very small thing, right? And you know, if I'm going to thread the needle, I got to have my glasses, plus a magnifying glass. To thread this needle, and she probably got some equipment to help her. It's hard. You keep missing it. Then you got to go to the right side. You keep missing it. But what I'm saying is that he's saying that it's almost impossible from someone that has acquired a lot of wealth to get to heaven. But it can't happen. But Jesus just felt that he should admit to that, so everybody won't be so after that and missing him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Is that okay?
Yes.
Let's look at Genesis 16. Genesis 16. I'm talking about in Genesis 16, a woman by the name of Sarah and a man by the name of Abraham. God spoke to Abraham and told him that he was going to have a child. And when God told Abraham that he was going to have a child, of course he shared it with his wife, Sarah. But once God said that, about 11 years had passed, and no child. Now, the first thing we have to ascertain is, did I actually hear from God? You have to understand that God is an infinite God. He's a God of infinity. He's an eternal God. So a few years are nothing to God.
That's
right. So God told you and spoke to you so that you can have something that when trying times come, so that you can maintain your focus on what he said.
Amen.
Is that okay? Let's read. Now, Sarah, Abraham's wife. Let's see here. I'm going to read. That's that fifth verse. Now, Sarah, Abraham's wife, bare him no children, and she had a handmaid, an Egyptian, who was named Hagar. And Sarah said unto Abraham, behold now, the Lord has restrained me from death. I pray thee, go in unto my maid. It may be that I may obtain children by her. And Abram hearkened to the voice of Sarah. And Sarah, Abraham's wife, took Hagar and her maid, the Egyptian, after Abraham had dwelt 10 years in the land of Canaan, and gave her to her husband, Abram, to be his wife. And he went into Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, her mistress was despised in her eyes. In other words, when the woman got pregnant, she started some trouble in the house. Sarah Abraham's wife, and Hagar, Sarah's mistress, when Sarah permitted Abraham to go in to Hagar, she conceived, and that started trouble in the house. But God said, Abraham, I'm going to call you to have a child by your wife. But since then, you know, you have to understand that 11 years now have passed from the time that God spoke. And they were getting antsy. Perhaps Sarah was getting antsy. And Abraham could have spoken against it, but he didn't. He didn't. And I'm going to leave my opinions to myself. He went in. She conceived. And that started trouble.
Yes.
Because I got to put it on the man and the woman, they did not maintain their focus on what God said. So that relationship, that child, Ishmael, with his name when he was born, caused trouble. Abraham understood fully what God said. So when God spoke to him, he was around 75 years old. So 11 years, 75, 85, you know, 86 years old, still no child, whatever. This promised child did not come until Abraham was around 100 years old. So what I'm saying is that God has the tools to fix whatever is broke down. Well, let me put it in labor's term. Sarah was unable to have children. And of course, Abraham, because, you know, could produce a child. So God had the wherewithal, the tools, the genius to fix both of them so they could have a child. And I guess they were preoccupied with that age. I wish somebody was going to pray with me. And you know, if they didn't put it all in the Bible, Sarah perhaps would say, well, you know, Abraham, I'm such and such age, I ain't had a child yet. So why don't we do this? So not realizing that if God said it, God had the power to fix it. Because everything that God has created in this world, it must bow to the authority of God. Everything. There is nothing upon the face of this earth that has the potential to stand against God. But everything must bow to the will of God. Abraham's body had to bow. Sarah's body had to bow. But no, they became preoccupied with age and what they could see. And therefore, they messed the thing up. I told you, you can get in the way of God. See, God didn't mean for all that trouble that Ishmael and Isaac, all that trouble that was going to come afterwards. I mean, that those nations became enemies. See, you're looking at it, okay, just a child, Ishmael. See, God said a nation.
Come on now.
Oh, the child, okay, Isaac. God said a nation.
Yeah, all right.
And those nations had trouble, and they still having trouble now.
Yes, teach, absolutely.
Teach. You can get in his way.
Absolutely.
But you have to do it God's way.
Yes.
So you must always learn to maintain your focus on him. Now the Bible says in Proverbs 3:5-6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and not lean unto your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, he shall direct your path. I'm almost finished. Now, Job 14:1 says, man that is born of a woman of a few days is full of trouble. In other words, life is going to present to us all kinds of troubles, such as sickness, financial problems, loss of a business, loss of a home, the recent possession of a car, the loss of a job, making it difficult to maintain your present lifestyle because your income has been cut in half. Trouble, 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 nothing but more trouble. But, somebody say but. But if you will learn to maintain your focus in God and in things of God, you will find that God is always with you, even in the midst of trouble, and his grace will be more than enough to see you through. The Bible says, weeping may endure for the night, but joy will come in the morning. The Apostle Peter, here is a companion within his boat, out of the sea, out of the lake, whatever you want to call it. And a storm came up, and Jesus was walking on the water during the storm. He was walking in the water, and there the boat was. And his disciples saw Jesus. They were afraid, and Jesus said, be not afraid, it is I. And Peter said, Lord, if that's you out there, can I come out there? And the Lord said, come on, Peter. So Peter stepped out of the boat in the storm and began to walk on water. He was doing fine. He was doing fine. Somebody said he was doing fine. Until he began to be preoccupied with the storm. When he was preoccupied with the storm, that meant that he can't maintain his focus on God and the storm at the same time. So he was preoccupied, and guess what? He began to sink. And Jesus helped him up and asked him this question. Wherever he is, your faith, or your little faith. So he didn't maintain his focus. Had he maintained his focus on Jesus, they could have been out there on the water dancing together.
Right.
Dancing on the water. But no, he was preoccupied with what he could see. But you can't be preoccupied with things that you can see, because you have to learn how to maintain your focus on God. Is that okay, everybody? Did I help anybody?
Yes.
Give the Lord a hand. Amen.